questions, whatever it puts in. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord speaks to us, His disciples, today. Come, follow me. Renounce yourselves, take up your cross, and come after me. May these words call us away from ourselves, and may the Lord go always with you.
And also with you.
Our Sunday Mass is the high point of our Christian living, at least I hope it is. It expresses intensely what we try to live every day. Everything we think and say and do, our everyday life, as St. Paul says, must give honor and praise to God. That's why we sum it up in our liturgy every week. In turn, the Eucharist becomes the living source of a deeper commitment to God and people. You know that. You know we preach in the Eucharist. A daily life that contradicts our Sunday worship is a distortion, and it's a parody of religion. So let us ask the Lord that our everyday life may worship God in spirit and in truth. We want an easy religion, of course, without demand, without sacrifices, without any cost to ourselves. So let's ask the Lord to forgive us. Lord Jesus, you resolutely took away to Jerusalem to suffer there and to die for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus Christ, you wanted to remain faithful to the Father who sent you and to us, whom you loved and wanted to save. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you invite us to remain faithful with you to our mission in life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and forgive us our cowardice and our compromises. Give us your determination and courage, and lead us to everlasting life. Mm-hmm. Let us pray. God, our Creator, today we bring you the perfect worship of your Son, Jesus Christ. With him we praise and thank you by offering ourselves with him. May this offering not be confined to the fleeting moment of this Eucharist, but burst forth in the life of every day through our love of you and our dedicated service to the people given to us to cherish and to share with what we are and with what we have. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
You duped me, O God, and I will let myself be duped. You were too strong for me, and you triumphed. All day I'm an object of laughter. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I must cry out. Violence and outrage is my message. The word of Most High has brought me derision and approach all the day. I say to myself, I will not mention our God, nor will I speak in our God's name anymore. But then it becomes like a fire burning in my heart, imprisoned in my bones, and growing weary, holding it. I cannot endure it. The word of God.
Thanks
be to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to the disciples that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and religious scholars, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside. He began to yell at him, "Look, Rabbi, this will never happen to you." Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Oh, really? Get yourself behind me, you Satan. You are trying to make me stumble and fall. You are setting your mind not on the things of God, but on the things of mortal men." Then Jesus said to the disciples, if you wish to come after, you must deny your very selves, take up the instrument of your own death, and begin to follow in my footsteps. If you would save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you would lose your life for my sake, guess what? You're going to find it. What profit would you show if you gained the whole world, but lost yourself? What can you offer in exchange for your very self? The Promised One will come in the glory of Abba God, accompanied by the angels, and will repay all according to their conduct. The good news of our salvation.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Here we go again with the special ed students. Not getting there. And Peter, Mr. Macho Man, should be playing that song in the background, from the Village People. Macho, Macho Man, because that's what he thought he was. Right? We go back to him walking on the water, and now he takes Jesus aside and starts yelling at him.
He takes over.
He takes over. Take it over, dude. Not you. He still didn't get it. Okay? That's the gospel. But in getting ready for today, I wanted to concentrate on the second reading, not the gospel, okay? A little something different. And it has to do from Paul's letter that you read to the Christians living in Rome. St. Paul lived in the first century, A.D., when the dominant religions were all pagan. Keep that in mind. Pagan religions were based on the belief in the power of external rituals. These sometimes consisted of sacrifices in which animals were slaughtered, grain was burned, or wine was poured out. And sometimes it even consisted of ritual dances, ritual prayers, songs, or similar actions. In every case, the power of worship was supposed had the ability to convince the false gods to send blessings on those they were worshiping, depending on how they did the ritual. So a very ritualistic base. It was like a gymnastics routine in the Olympics. If the ritual wasn't performed with perfect precision, the worshiper would get a bad score. And the gods would rather ignore the prayer or get angry. This pagan focus on the external rituals had also seeped, if you think of it, into the Jewish practices of the time. Think of the story of we're going to sacrifice my son. He was willing to sacrifice his son, Abraham, ready to, And God's like, okay, cool. I see you're with me. You're willing to go that far. So what does it continue to say? There was a sheep or a ram stuck in the bushes, so that's what they killed. So you can see how it, went. Even in the Old Testament, when we had with Pharaoh and the last plague, what did he say to put on the doorpost? To put the blood of the sacrificial lamb so the angel would know to skip over that house and not kill the firstborn son. So you can see how it snuck in. So throughout his writings, St. Paul is constantly warning the early Christians against falling into ritualism. He's training the early church to have a close relationship with God, not a cold, distant relationship that's clogged up with empty formalities. This is why he writes to the Romans, just as we just heard, offer your bodies as a living and holy sacrifice pleasing to God, your spiritual worship. In other words, what he's telling them is this: that their relationship with God isn't reduced to just rituals and prayers. Everything we do is meant to be a worship. Now, way back in the prehistoric days when I was going to this Catholic school, and I got off my dinosaur in front of the school, our morning prayer consisted of the morning offering. Do any of you maybe are old enough, I'm going to be careful how I go here, to remember that prayer?
Yes. I couldn't say it now.
But you remember hearing the morning offering?
I remember it.
We prayed it.
Yeah, the morning offering. Oh Jesus, through the Immaculate Heart of Mary, I offer you my prayers, joys, works, and sufferings of this day in union with your Sacred Heart. I don't know, I'm pretty good. Those nuns really got it to me, you know?
That's how we did it.
And so we were doing this. We were offering our whole day, everything we did, good and bad. It was supposed to be worship. And if it was bad, help us to, you know, turn it around. So our actions, our words, our decisions, the way we live our daily lives, all these things are a way for us to show our love of Christ and want to follow Him. You have it best out of all of us.
Do I?
Because yeah, I don't know what you do for a living, but he's a teacher.
Oh, okay.
So you don't know what those kids are going to come to you like every day. That's what I used to love about teaching.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know what you're going to get.
It's like
it was like a wonderful experience. Schoolers. I had, you know, K through 8.
Yeah.
You know, so those middle schoolers are, they're a work of art.
Oh, they are.
No, you know, because you don't know. You know, one day I'd see this one kid and, you know, happy-go-lucky and everything, and then the next day they come in like the weight of the world is on their shoulders. You know, because maybe a boy said something wrong to them that they were infatuated with, or their parents, you know, whatever. So that's why that's why I used to love it, because you never knew what you were going to get.
He's still thinking about it.
Then as assistant principal, the principal was even better for him, because I got to go to the whole blessed school. I wasn't stuck in a classroom.
That was awesome. That's probably.
Because I could see everybody. You know? When I did the alternative classroom, I didn't know if Robbie Kirko was going to hide the whole day under the desk. You know, that's the way he was. He had some issues. He had some baggage. All my alternative kids did. So it was so cool, because it let me, as I was preparing the homily, it led me to, you know, thinking back to my whole day being a prayer. How am I going to pray, so to speak? And my dealings with the people. And it's the same thing with all of you. Your calls, you might get good calls, you might get upset calls. You know, how are you going to deal with them? You know, you're going to go over to Brookdale. Maybe Bob's in a good mood. Maybe all of a sudden you might go over and Bob is in one hell of a mood. And it's like, how are you, Bob? You know, you don't know where you live. You don't know what your fellow neighbors are going to be like. You know, so
they're going to smile or say good morning,
yeah,
or even say my name.
Yeah, so
I always say good morning.
Even though if you're there.
You know, with Graham over at Reiki, the same thing. You know, he told me, what was it? The guy that wouldn't go to sleep. Remember, you told me last week there was a guy that wouldn't go to sleep.
Yeah. He was up all night.
Yeah. How do you deal with it? You know, you should be sleeping.
Sunday, I mean.
You know, the whole thing. So this is a challenge for us. You know, when we leave here today, you know, we're in traffic. Are we going to give the royal blessing on to the other person that might have just cut us off? You know, giving giving the pontifical blessing but forgetting a finger. You know, it's a challenge. That's what Paul is getting at in the second reading for us. You know, everything shows our love for Christ. At that time, that was a radical concept in religion, back in Paul's time. A religion built on a personal friendship with, wait a minute, one God? They had tons of gods. But now you're saying there's only one God? Who became man and this dude that hung around here called Jesus Christ? And so Paul wrote, if you remember what was read, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Every aspect of our lives, everything we do, can glorify God. Build up the kingdom. The greatest Catholic apologist, and apologist doesn't mean, oh, I'm sorry, I'm Catholic. Let me explain. I'm sorry. It doesn't mean that, apology like that. An apologist is someone who tries to make the faith real to people, to make them understand it. G.K. Chesterton was a good one. He once said that when he became a believer, it even changed the way he brushed his teeth. This was one of the reasons why Christianity is such a dynamic religion. It's not limited to the sacristy or to the altar. It overflows into everything we do and fills us with desires to do more and more and more. That's what we can't forget. One of Pope John Paul II's favorite phrases was a line given to us by the Saint Paul Irenaeus in the 3rd century. The glory of God is man fully alive. Think about that. The glory of God is man, naturally we mean that in the generic sense, fully alive.
Like looked about a miracle.
Yeah. The Christian God is a parent who rejoices in seeing his kids grow and flourish. Years ago, a book came out that told the story of a young man who had been drafted into the Russian Communist Army. He was a Russian who loved his country, but he was also a Christian. Of course, Russian communism had no room for Christianity. It was an atheistic social system, as pretty much as it is today, still. And so during his training, the officers paid special attention to him because he was a Christian. They were constantly looking for opportunities to humiliate in front of the other soldiers, to make his life miserable, so that he would give up his Christian faith. But no matter how closely they watched him, they couldn't find anything to punish him for. In every point of military discipline, he was the top soldier. He was always on time. His uniform looked, you know, brand spanking sharp, like it was supposed to be. His performance was exceptional. His knowledge was always complete. He was a Christian, and so everything he did, from KP duty to the parade ground, he did it with love and excellence, making his whole life into that prayer that was pleasing to the Creator. Our relationship, all of us here, our relationship with God is not based on external rituals. You know how I get upset when we get too ritualistic. Look at us. We're not ritualistic here. We have the elements of worship, but we adapt. You know, we don't stick. My nose isn't in a book. You know, that's the cool part. You know, when you think, what was the Last Supper like? It was more like this. It wasn't Jesus in the middle with the bread and the wine, and he's like, okay, wait a minute. What does the book say? What do I need to do now? wasn't like that. You know? And there wasn't, you know, a stenographer next to him writing everything down. Or Dr. Phil in the background said, so what do you really mean by that statement, Jesus? There wasn't. You know? So it can't be. It's our internal identity. All of us here worship God in a different way. Personally. I don't think if we were, you know, if I wanted to get that personal and ask me, I don't think there'd be two of us that do it the same way. Which is the cool part, because we're all individuals. We're not puppets of God. You know, you've heard me say before, it produced the song from Pinocchio. I got no strings to hold me down. God isn't pulling the strings. He gave us free will. You know, it's so cool. You know, and when we received baptism, that was like our... Okay, I'm officially a Christian. That original sin is washed away, and I'm on my own. You know, that was the new plan. Now, there are two areas where this can be really played out in our lives, and where, me too, we're often tempted to slide back into another practical paganism of saying, we believe in one thing and doing another. You heard me say the past couple of weeks, I got to start doing what I preach, practice what I preach. Especially with my situation that's going on. I can't tell you one thing and then, you know, do the next. No. You know? What do we like? Do we just come here for Sunday because we're a cute little group?
Yeah, that's kind of.
Or does it nourish you to hear the word of God, to hear my words, but I don't want to say it's my words, I like to think it's the Holy Spirit encouraging me. And then you're all like that, and then what do you like Monday morning? I used to say that you see true Catholicism in the parking lot after Mass.
Well, poor that is so true. Everybody refers to.
That's where you saw. Well, they just left. They just left Mass. They just left Mass, and then they're in the parking lot to get up.
Boom!
You know, and I'm like, okay, negate everything they just saw. And what they can do that is push on again. Right? I'm like,
oh God.
You know, but that's it's so true. I think I remember mentioning it here at one time. When growing up in Boston in the 70s, when Judge Arthur Garrity had forced integration in the Boston public schools. So here are the folks in South Boston, which is highly Irish, and I'm not picking on them, but this is the way it is. It's highly Irish, highly Catholic. Okay, and here they are at church on Sunday. I'm going to say a naughty word. And here they are, on Monday at South Boston High School throwing eggs and saying, you goddamn Ennis.
Oh, okay.
Yet the day before, at St. Augustine's in South Boston, they're all like this. That's what I mean. That's what I mean. You must take your faith out there. When we say we're ambassadors of Jesus, it's true. You've got to be. They look at you and say, whoa, I can tell they're a Christian. Just by the way they are. Remember, like I said before, what Francis said. You know? Spread the gospel. Use words if you have to. So you're doing it by your lives. That's what Paul means. The second place we can screw up is our family relationships. A man may be organized, polite, punctual, self-sacrificing at work, but at home can be lazy, temperamental, self-indulgent, you know, or Somebody can be charming, patient, forgiving, and delightful at a social event, and moody, grudging, and resentful with her family. That's not the Christian way. You don't put on a mask, like that commercial for depression, you know, that's out there. You don't put that mask on, oh, I'm a Christian, man. And then I take it off. Every day needs to be like that. So, the Christian way is to make a decent effort to reflect Christ all the time, 24/7, 365, to make our lives a living sacrifice to God. And what does Jesus ask of us? Give it a shot. That's what he was telling the apostles every time. Do I expect you to be perfect? No! But give it a shot. Just give it a shot. If we do that, I can assure you, because I'm speaking from personal experience, His grace will take care of the rest. You've got to be His ambassadors. I've said enough.
Well, you're not musical.
Ambassadors.
Oh, ambassadors.
Yeah,
like you said.
Yeah.
Well, that's my two cents.
That is serious enough. I've gone to 3 sunrise Easter services. Outdoors, beautiful, everything, and you get connected. It's a Methodist church. It just turned out cold, and that's like no Christian, no Christianity. I was a drop-off for another year. Period. I don't even know today if I was supposed to call myself Christian. But in terms of Jesus as the Son of God, but having that spirit in that, to me, is enough.
We haven't done it all that, so feel free to chime in. I'm not the end all be all.
But I remember the offertory. You know, the repetition at the time it was born, but it gave me so much hope with two children with their brain chemistry imbalances and the long-term dysfunction on that.
Oh, most definitely.
Gave me hope. That just dedicate everything I do that day, and then, but not be a doormat. That was the first 20 years.
Second that one.
Yes.
The birds of the sun.
It happens.
I'm right there with you.
Yeah,
I have to. I have to leave. Bye.
Go with your children, it makes a lot.
Yeah, I didn't have that. That was good for it.
Yeah, in the second reading, what came to my mind is that, like, being a Christian was illegal at that time. Like, you had to be so convinced of your religion that you had to be willing to die. Pretty much sacrificing your entire body and being in existence.
That's pretty heavy.
Sadly, a lot of people are still doing that.
Mm-hmm. And I'm like thinking about that and thinking about what we have been living through lately. To some people, it seems to be such a small thing, but to some of us, it's something so huge. The statues, politics. I never in my life thought I could end up myself. Because going to school, you always had such ignorant stupidity going on in your mentality that it was just like, how the hell did this place, how can we be just a few miles apart? And our mindset, like, Virginia is so close to us. And the stuff that happens in Virginia, it's like, you would think it's like in Russia and Siberia. It's like, I hear sometimes of some people of color living in certain places, and I tremble for them, I shake for them, because Orlando's such a tiny little country place. I'm condemned to live here. See how I'm in so much pain. I have spent a weekend in bed. I have to get up because my dog makes one. But every time I walk into, I have to see this stupid statue. And I was like, I don't want to be arrested, but I mean, think I've even moved it from here.
Oh.
But this week, you know what the statue have to do with this?
These people all call themselves Christians. These people all call themselves Christians. They own 100 slaves, but they're Christians. They are the symbol of Christianity. They are the biggest Christians ever, but they want to have a statue of somebody who said, you're less than a human being. I mean, like, we should be celebrating that. And then we have a nurse who goes and kills 200 elderly person in a nursing home. Why do we build a statue for her? Why don't we build a statue for her? Why don't we build a statue for that dude that killed everybody at Pulse? We should be building him a statue. You know what I'm saying? And people call themselves Christians, and it's like, well, how much are we willing to offer? We can even offer a little compassion for other. You can even look at other human beings and look at them and see another human person. We see somebody less than that. And these are Christians. So, you know how we have spoken about questioning our faith? I do it all the time. And you wonder, like, you know, you're talking to somebody you appreciate and you love and all that. Then come to find out this is the same person that, you know what I'm saying, adheres to a certain mentality. You know, that it's like, I don't have to speak to you.
But you know what? By the same token, and I understand what you're saying, when you find out what the person is like, you don't speak to them anymore. But then by the same token, what are you doing? You know, which is what God
I was going to bring that up.
Yeah. What God doesn't want us to do. Let's talk. Let's
right. See. Love your enemy. Love those that
and
want
see
to hurt
how.
You.
It's tough. It is very hard. Oh, yes, it is.
In every situation,
of course.
Oh, yeah. You know, sometimes people are really toxic and you have to completely pull back.
Very toxic.
And others,
that's
you know, they may be moody. So if they're.
And yet they call themselves the ultimate Christians. They're the symbol of Christianity.
I've been here, what, 30 some years. I never honestly paid attention to. What you were talking about the statues or anything, I never really paid attention. It was like I was blind to them, if you would. And now that it's been brought up and all of this and all of that, you know, they keep saying, well, this is our history. This is what we were. And okay, it is part of history. It did happen.
It's a disgraceful part of history.
But
that hopefully can be erased and put aside.
Don't have to be
something better be brought up.
In my opinion. What I don't like is that we're showing off and bringing this person to a higher level than, in my opinion, it should be. Let's make it a part of history. Yes, it happened. Yes, this person did this, did that, owned these many, liberated that many, whatever
you
it was.
See,
that
I mean, you bring up an excellent point. That's something we see every day. You wouldn't notice that. I notice it every day, baby. I don't have a choice. Because my face is my identity. Not you. You might be Hispanic, but among us there are lots of. And you know, we have our own problems too.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Do you notice how that brings it even more evident that you didn't even notice that? I do. I just came here to the South and leaving New York and I was like, oh Lord, I have to see where am I going? I mean, I really wanted to go to Canada, but the time is cold too. I just didn't have to be somewhere.
Yeah.
But you know, I come from a place where we have. I mean, it was so funny. I was reading this word, Puerto Rico. We have like all shades between white and black, right? Because of the Indian, you know, blacks, everything. And so the mix and match of people has given us a range of color, if you would. And it's amazing. The two things have come to mind with that. First, that we, in general in Puerto Rico, we make distinctions. Oh, that
one. Oh,
the light, dark one. The dark, dark one. The darkest, dark. The black. You know, we identify with color a lot. And another thing that came within our culture, we are very, in a way proud, but in another way very discriminatory as well. this week, I was reading, I can't remember what it was I was reading, but it was something relating to the one thing that Hispanics have to be thankful to Mr. Trump about is that he has brought us together against him. You know?
It's a Christian place known as the most Christian place.
What? Puerto Rico? Yes.
You know, I have been given tickets. My ex-boyfriend bought
me. You've been given tickets for
what? To go to Puerto Rico.
Oh.
And I refused to go.
What?
I would not set foot in Puerto Rico if my life, if my
never
salvation
say never.
Was there. Oh, I
say never. Never.
I stay away from Puerto
Why?
Rico.
Why?
Because such a Christian place, such a sick, racist place, that I would never go. On. I have lost tickets, just nope, I'm not going. I would not set foot in Puerto Rico even if I like it.
I was sent to the show. After the story you told last week?
Oh, no.
That, on my beats.
Oh,
I'm afraid to ask.
No, but that's not much of racial. That's a culture.
No, I understand that, but
that's
is there
culture.
Racial incentiveness? Okay. All right, so you think about that. Obviously, we have it here. No matter how many people say, as someone who taught history, even while I was teaching history, it's still going on. The discrimination is still there because of color. And if you've heard me say before, in the gay and lesbian community, one of my classic lines is that the community yells about being discriminated against, but they discriminate so wonderfully within the community.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
You know, I can only speak for the guys part, but, you know, it's like, okay, you know, we have the classifications. You're a twink. You're a shark. You're a this. You're a that. And you know, you don't talk because you don't look like a GQ model, or you don't look. It's like, and then we throw in the color part. You know, too. That's before the color. Then you throw in the color part. The color part and racial. You know, hey, I don't talk to Asians. You know, I don't care how cute they are. And it's like, wow.
You mean
but that
a lot of gay men.
Yeah. I can't speak for the lesbian side. Yeah.
But that, it's just the show, you know.
Yeah.
Jose is saying he would never sit for Puerto Rico because of. Right. Well, you know, if we, in my opinion, if we assume that attitude, then we are just closing ourselves more and more. And being less accepting and less willing to do wants us
right.
to do.
And it's not, and I'm not saying you're right, wrong, I'm not here to chastise you or judge you. The idea is, if we're going to try, keyword try, to be Christ's ambassador, then using this situation, then it's like, all right, I'm going to give it a shot. I'm going to go. I might not like it, but at least I gave it a shot, and if I could maybe plant seeds, maybe with one or two people, then I've done Christ's work. Doesn't mean I have to convince the whole island, you know, but it starts with small. That's what Christ did. We're not the lucky ones that are going to get 5,000 and we sit on a hillside and go, all right now, listen up. You know,
I've been... My father was in the military, and told him my folks divorced. Well, he was still in the military, but when I was about 12. So I've lived a lot of places, and I've traveled a lot on my own. I've had the pleasure of going to England and Netherlands. And I've been extensively in the Midwest. My ex-husband was from there, and we had went a lot. And I've been in the Northeast, because I happened to live with a man there that was from Massachusetts. And I've traveled around there, and I've traveled to Maine. So I'm not seeing people be any nicer in northern or different places than I have here in the South. So I think that you can be ignorant and racist
anywhere,
every place. And I found that more than not, I found good people all over the world. And I've been to Puerto Rico 3 times, and I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Wow.
Well, so. You're from Boston.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very liberal place.
It's
the melting pot. It's the melting pot. Yet the Irish are here, the Portuguese are here, the bees are here,
those
are there.
We got the ghettos.
I mean, it is what Jackie's saying. It doesn't matter where, you will find.
Well,
there's no place that is so open and welcoming that.
Except New York City.
I can give you a perfect example. When I was a child.
I know, there's no space for.
Yeah, my aunt.
The Walter Brown said, "Oh, I don't want this album."
My aunt used to have a lady to help her clean.
Uh-huh.
And she would go pick her up. Renee,
where was it?
In Virginia.
In Virginia.
And the funny thing was is that my aunt and Martha were buds.
Yeah.
My aunt would clean with Martha.
She paid her to clean and she would clean.
She hired Martha to clean, but they both cleaned. And you know, they got along very famously. So they were friends. So it wasn't really just like
boss.
Yeah, I'm your boss.
Yeah.
You know, it was very strange. We got a really kick out of it. But my aunt was a very surprising lady. She would really rather mow the yard and trim bushes and stuff like that. She was a terrible cook. So she was a very.
You can't have it all day.
She was very much a feminist, I guess. You think
she
of herself
like
that
it,
way.
Yeah.
She liked to manage rental property, and she wasn't highly educated because she left school early. But she was.
You don't have to be book educated to be educated.
She was a cool lady. Right.
You have many people that have doctorates and that have. Whatever, and they are total able,
yep.
You know.
Although one
show thing, nothing for in, for being
yeah, for being
educated.
I think if I could just say one thing to what Jose said. In other words, why go somewhere where we know we're not going to have a good time?
When we know
that's how I'm trying to tie all this up to Christianity. New York City, though. In all honesty, is such a melting pot. Well, Boston is Boston. You got the Yankees, and you got your statues, by the way. They have the statues.
Oh, yeah.
They have the Red Sox. We have the.
No. She's talking
about New York. There's so many pockets, and there is prejudice there. But there's so many pockets of different people. You could walk in the street and hear five languages spoken. But it is the greatest city in the world. Because I lived there, but sort of coming from there, where we have that spirit so down here where there is, people are friendly, but they are, that's like friendly in different way down south, I mean, you know.
Well, the thing is this,
but I agree with you.
Everybody here is, what I'm telling you, isn't from the south.
Yeah.
Right.
It's just like, I'm from the home of the Navy Yard, Virginia, and there are so many foreign people from all over there. So every place you go, every one of us isn't a southern bumpkin just because you live here and you live in Virginia.
Oh, no.
There's a lot of other people that you meet. And, you know, I remember taking Spanish in school, and I didn't have many Spanish people to speak to then. I had to listen to tapes. However, now, when you go to Norfolk, there's tons of Spanish people. So, you know, I still get down to, no, we're not in New York, we're not a major, we're not a Boston, we're not Miami, we're not Amsterdam.
But it's definitely cosmopolitan.
But there's a lot of things here. You know, we're not going to turn into New York, but there's nice people here.
Oh, yeah.
in my opinion.
So I hear what all of you are saying, and you're right, for today. Now, even think back on the time of Christ.
Yeah.
Jews didn't get along with Samaritans. Not the sad. I'm talking the different. The past 3 weeks, there's been references in the scriptures to these other cultures that technically people were getting ticked off at Jesus because he was associating with those people. How can you, as a Jew, associate? So this is nothing new. Than we see. But the thing I want to close out and keep in mind, and I'm using the translation I have here, not the one that the common read in the second reading, do not conform yourselves to this age, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And that can be said to us today. Don't conform to today. If you're truly a Christian, and you've heard me say this time and time and time again, and I'll probably still be in my casket saying, if you're a dirt, just listen at the break, you'll then keep on saying, if you're truly a Christian, then you're the biggest SOB going. Think about that for a minute. Because what was Christ for his era? He was the one that brought society of his day. And we must do the same.
He stepped out of the box.
Yeah, we have to do the same when we see injustice being done. We just can't sit by.
When we moved to the States, my ancestors and I, back in 1981,
30 years ago,
we moved to La Crosse, Wisconsin. The first thing we were told when we stepped off the plane, don't speak Spanish here. Why? That's our language. Because the Nariel airlift from Cuba had just started inhabiting, and they were shipping a lot of the refugees to a little bit north of La Crosse, and they were wreaking havoc there. I mean, the women were going crazy with the Cuban men, and it went above and beyond just having fun, you know, a lot of raping and a lot of. They were going crazy, both sides. And you don't want to be associated with. Mm-hmm. And I remember telling the lady that, I said, you know, for me to not speak Spanish is like not being myself. Then maybe I should show you. And back then I wasn't as involved with church as I am now. Maybe I should show you that being Hispanic mm-hmm. and speaking Spanish has nothing to do really with what's going on. Mm-hmm. It just so happens, you know, unfortunately, that that group is doing what they're doing, but that doesn't mean that we're all the same.
What we're talking about, the Midwest is totally, totally white.
Well,
and has.
And then I wasn't going to say that, but I'm brought there, you know. And my husband and my ex-husband and I would go wherever we needed to go, and amongst ourselves, we'd be speaking Spanish. And they would look at us like, uh oh, you know. The first look was that, what have we got?
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
Birds of a feather.
And then we lived there for 3.5 years, and to this day, I say, if it weren't that far and that cold, and I would be alone up there, I would not mind living there at all. I loved it. With all of the looks and everything that I got for a few things that were funny, others, it was just this kind of thing.
Sure.
You're not white.
Sure.
You don't speak Spanish. And they let you know. They would look at me and say, where are you from? Because you're not white, right?
I don't think that's what you could use humor.
I'll throw in another thing.
Yeah, you go, I'm a white. You're not a white, I'm a white.
A lot of people think if you're a Muslim person, you're probably going to be a terrorist. And
exactly.
You know that isn't true.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's a real hard one.
Exactly. More and so nowadays.
Even the diocese here in Orlando has had classes in different parishes on that very subject to hopefully teach the parishioners. Just because someone is Muslim doesn't mean
they're bad.
Exactly. You know, and again, and as usual, we could go on for hours.
As you can tell.
And it's good because we learn from each other. And the Holy Spirit works through you, not just me.
Well, I'm reading it is not the same as talking about it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Right. So the main thing is, it's not easy, but try your best. That's all that Christ wants. Mm-hmm. So now let's move on and profess our faith by